Wonderful, thank you. Good morning. The Bible reading this morning is taken from John chapter 3, verses 16 to 21. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting, eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in an order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people loved the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does that is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God.
Thanks, Annie. Let's just spend a bit of time praying before we delve into God's word. Lord, we thank you for your word and the wonderful ways in which it reveals you to us, the wonderful ways in which it reveals your character and also our character as well, and the ways in which we are so different from you. And Lord, I pray this morning that our time through John chapter 3 would just be a real blessing to us, that we would be just have our eyes open to your character and to your love for us. Lord, we just ask for your blessing upon this time now, in Jesus' name. Amen. You might have heard of a guy named Tim Tebow. He is the... Just put it back on proclaim for me, James, and then my clicker will work. If you go to the next image for me. Tim Tebow is the quarterback, or was the quarterback, for the Florida Gators. And in 2009, he initially wore Philippians 4:13 on his eye black. You might be able to see that very faintly on under his eyes war paint or something like that. But he wore the Bible verse, Philippians 4:13, which says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Well, this time in January 2009, before the game, a very big game, he had the idea or felt the prompting to change the Bible verse under his eyes. And he actually changed it to John 3:16. The Gators won the game. As I said, Tim Tebow is the quarterback, and so he plays a very crucial role in the team. And the Gators won the game, and they moved forward to the National College Finals. As they were celebrating with a dinner afterwards, the coach received a phone call from their public relations guy. And the public relations guy mentioned that during the game, because of what Tim Tebow was wearing under his eyes, 94 million people Googled John 3:16. And it would go on to be the most searched item for the next 72 hours. When he heard this, Tebow's response was, "How do 94 million people not know what John 3:16 says? You know, it's Sunday School 101. Well, fast forward to 3 years later, January 2012, and Tim Tebow's now playing for the Denver Broncos, and they played against the Pittsburgh Steelers. and it was the first game in the playoffs, like their semi-finals. He was still wearing John 3:16 under his eye black, and he thought that the impact of that had been sort of, you know, it had waned a little bit. But after the Broncos won the game, the same PR guy pulled Tebow aside and he actually said, "Do you know what has happened?" And Tebow said, "Yeah, we won and we're going on to play the Patriots." And the PR guy said, "No, you don't understand what happened. During the game, again, 90 million people Googled John 3:16, but Tebow, as the quarterback, threw for 316 yards. The average yards per rush for his team were 31.6 yards. Tebow's average yards per completion were 31.6. And the TV ratings of the last 15 minutes of the game were 31.6. Of course, this would have been quite the shock for Tebow. It would have been, I thought God had finished doing what he was going to do with John 3:16. But he was reminded that God continues to do great and wonderful things through people who step out in faith and do something simple as put John 3:16 on their eye black. In Christian circles, it's probably the most well-known verse, John 3:16. We could all perhaps quote it off by heart. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." Yes, I read that. I didn't quote it off the top of my head. Let's break this verse down phrase by phrase and have a look at some of the truths that are in this verse. Firstly, it's unclear as if these words are actually from Jesus himself as he continues on his conversation with Nicodemus, or whether they're added in by John as a bit of a commentary to Jesus' interactions with Nicodemus. But regardless of who spoke them or who wrote them down, this is still God's word and it still rings an amazing truth for us. So this verse begins with John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." The "for" there ties it back into the verses beforehand with the previous interaction with Nicodemus about Moses lifting up the serpent in the desert and the Son of Man being lifted up in the same sort of way on the cross. Verses 14 and 15 say, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." It tells us that God's motivation towards people is love. God's not limited in his love for just a few people or a select group of people, but his love and his gift of the Son is for the whole world. Now, this statement would have been quite the challenge to Jewish readers because they thought that God just loved Israel. God only loved Israel, his select group of people. And it might be a challenge for us as well that God loves the world, because we might think that God only loves believers who have placed their faith and their trust in him. But the Bible tells us that God is love. God is love, that love is a characteristic of God, and that it's in his very nature to love. And so he loves all of his creation. He loves all of his people. Have a look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. I'll see if this is working. Jason, the little USB receiver If you unplug it and plug it back in for me, that would be awesome. But 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 9 says, "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance." So it's saying that God wishes that all people would come to a fully saving belief in him, a recognition of him as their creator and as their Lord. God's desire is that all would come to repent of their sins and place their faith in him and be saved. He loves all of his creation, and he desires that all would be saved and none would perish. But sadly, unfortunately, we know that that's not going to happen. But when we look at this verse and we see the greeting of "for God so loved the world," we can sometimes overemphasize this message of love. It can come across as God loves you just the way you are. Yes, God loves each one of us because he created us. And he made us unique and wonderful. And God loves us even when we're his enemies in sin. But this word here, "so," is not telling us how much God loves us or God loves the world, but how God loves the world. It's not telling us the degree or the amount of God's love, but the action of God's love. God's love is expressed through the giving of his Son. Next slide, please, James. And this is how we know that God loves us, that he gave his only Son. If God is willing to give up his only Son in order that, for the sake of humanity, that some might be saved from their sins and receive eternal life, so that we could have our relationship restored with him, then there's a great deal of love in God, isn't there? If he's willing to give up his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. But God didn't just give his Son as a human in order for the person Jesus to die, live a normal life, but he gave him in order that he might die the most excruciating death that a person could die. He suffered the anguish and the pain of the cross because God gave him. And this doesn't show the love of the Son, it shows the obedience of the Son, Jesus, who underwent all of this, but it shows the love of the Father. It's in the giving of the Son that God loves the world. And this is not the kind of romantic love that we sometimes think of, but it's a love that was so willing to do what was necessary, even despite the cost to the one and only Son. The giving of the Son has two aspects. It firstly reveals God's nature to us and character, that he is love, that he loves his world. But then secondly, it has a saving purpose for those whom God loves and those whom put their belief and faith in the Son. And that's what our next phrase gets to. That whoever believes in him. Now, verse 18 explains this a little bit further. Verse 18 says, "Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." So the giving of the Son and the love that is shown through it requires a response. And that response comes in the form of belief. This means to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he was given by the Father to show the love that he has for us, that he died the death that you and I deserve, and he paid the penalty for our sins. And because of this, he brings eternal life. This means to take Jesus at his word, to believe that what Jesus says about himself is true. And this means to believe and accept the love that God has for us and to live the way in which God desires us to live rather than for ourselves. But at the same time, belief is more than just something that happens in our heads. Now, suppose you are walking along a path in a national park, and you came across a bridge that crossed a deep canyon. You might look at it and think, you know, yes, it's got good wires and good structure and a good foundation, and my intellectual belief says that it would help me to cross this ravine. It would support my weight. Many of you would believe that you would turn around and go the other way because you wouldn't cross that bridge, no matter how good the foundation or structure. You might even see other people walking across this bridge that may be heavier or larger than you, and you believe, yeah, because of that, I believe that this bridge will support my weight. But so far, your belief is only in your head. You've only got an intellectual understanding of the belief in the bridge. And it's not until you put yourself out onto that bridge and you believe, because it is being done, that it will hold your weight. You only really believe when you're willing to commit your life to it and actually walk across it. And it's the same with belief in Jesus. It's only really belief until we're really willing to commit our life to it. It's more than just an intellectual agreement. It's more than just saying that I believe in Jesus. It's more than just saying that I believe that God is real and he has created us, because James tells us that even the demons believe and they shudder. To believe in Jesus is to commit our whole life and our eternal destination to him as well, to have confidence in him personally as our Lord and Savior. And when a person believes in this gift of eternal life, in this gift of the Son, they have eternal life as a benefit to them. The next phrase is that they should not perish. Now, the word perish means here to be destroyed or completely lost, utterly lost. Believing in Jesus as our Savior and Lord and committing our entire lives to him means that we should not perish. We will not perish. We won't be completely destroyed or lost. Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The wages or payment for the sin that we commit, and each one of us have committed sins, is death. The wages that we all deserve is death for our sins. And yet, the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord, which comes through faith and belief. So the belief in Jesus as Savior and Lord reverses this punishment for our sins. It not just reverses it, but it completely removes it. We will not perish, be destroyed or utterly lost. We will instead have eternal life through Jesus our Lord. We're all destined to die physically. And the next phrase is, but have eternal life. We're all destined to die physically, and after that comes a judgment. But for those who believe, who have lived their lives for God through the gift of Jesus the Son, have confidence that he has saved them from the punishment of their sins, and they will receive eternal life. For those that don't, they will perish. As it said earlier, they are already condemned. They will go to a Christless eternity. Now, I don't know about you, but this fills me with somewhat of a little bit of sadness for the sake of those who have never heard the name of Jesus, or for the sake of those who don't put their belief and faith in him. But at the same time, this verse fills me with so much joy that because of my belief in Jesus, because of our belief in Jesus, we have eternal life given to us. You see, we need to be driven by these words as much as we need to be encouraged by them. Not driven to save ourselves, but to driven to share the good news of Jesus with those around us, to pray for those who have never heard his name and who don't believe with their entire lives. What could be less complicated than belief? There's no quest to complete. There's no line of heritage to be a part of, as in Israel. There's no challenge to overcome. There's no status to reach. There's no payment to be made. But it is simply just to believe. We only have to trust the one who made us and who loves us and who sent his Son to die for our sins in our place so that we might have eternal life. Not just eternal life as if it's something that will happen when we die, but life now with God. The only thing that we need to do is believe with our entire lives. God will do and has done the rest. Let's read it again. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let me pray. Lord, we just thank you for the profound words that are contained within this one verse. The profound ways in which it shows your character. It shows your love towards us. It shows the immense gift of the Son, the price that he paid in order that we who believe might have eternal life, that we might have our sins forgiven and that we might have life with you now. Lord, I thank you for this one verse, and I pray that as we go from here, that you would help us to be reminded of the enormous foundational truths that are contained within this one verse. But Lord, would you help us also with our unbelief? Help us to continue to trust you with every aspect of our lives, both physical, emotional, and spiritual. I pray, Lord, that you would help us to apply this to our lives through Jesus' help. We pray this in his name. Amen. Thanks, Jody.
Our closing song this morning is Lord, I Lift